My name is Wafai Samuel.
I am an international media personality. And the subject for today rather is a subject matter I am very passionate about. Because like he has said, when a few people are opportunity to travel the world, to travel across, you know, different countries in Africa, we see how things work. There are basic necessities that are put in place that helps countries flourish. There are basic necessities that are put in place that help citizens of different countries work. And then when you come to my own country or you go to some other regions in Africa, you tend to realize that these necessities are a bit of a luxury. You struggle for survival, more or less you're your own government, more or less you provide basically everything you need to run your businesses and to live comfortably. Now the question is, can it be done? We admire some of the countries we travel to across Africa, like I said, internationally, and then we aspire to be like these countries. Is it possible? Can Nigeria ever get to that El Dorado? That is a question. But it would be a subject matter for some other time. So once again, before I begin with my presentation, I'd like you all to put your hands together for yourselves. Thank you so much for coming here. Clap for yourselves, please. You all deserve a round of applause. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Okay, so on behalf of the organizers and the publishers of Bliss Affairs magazine, I'd like to welcome you all to the 2019 edition of the Blissful Affairs Annual Discourse and Recognition Awards. It's the fifth anniversary, and we all know fifth is a milestone. It's not easy to have maintained the brand for 5 years. If you give birth to a child today, check back in 5 years and you realize that the child would have grown tremendously. And so 5 years is indeed a milestone. Please, the publisher of this magazine and the organizer of these awards, Ada, deserves a round of applause. Please put your hands together for her. Thank you. Thank you very much. And so today I'm tasked with a responsibility to speak on the topic, challenges and triumphs of Nigerian CEOs in the 21st century. Before I begin, I'd like to say I feel like a very small fish in a very big pond. And that's because I have my co-speaker, or the second speaker, as the DSP of police here in Lagos State. So please put your hands together for him. He's speaking after me. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Permit me to stand on the already existing protocols. I'd like to begin by saying that nobody sets out to be a bad CEO, run a business to a halt, run a business without making profits, or get in the midst of different bureaucracies that grinds their companies. Yet, no CEO in Nigeria or Africa ever has a compelling merry ride. Along these lines, a lot of things would definitely go wrong. I'm sure that virtually everybody who is sitting here, at least I'll say 60 to 70% of people here, have staff working under them. If you have a staff, if you have someone working under you, you're a manager, you're a CEO. And I mean, we all know the rudiments, the long stories, the story of our lives of employment in Nigeria. A lot of us are self-employed, a lot of people are self-employed, and so if you're self-employed, you are a CEO. If you have a business, you are a CEO. If someone is working under you as a staff, you are a CEO. And I'm sure, like I said, more than 70% of us here are CEOs. Now, Nigeria is one of the most marketable countries in the world, that's in this side of the world, rather in Africa, for prospective investors and entrepreneurs alike. With its vast population, abundance of natural resources, on the papers, it seems like one of the most ideal places to do business. It seems like an ideal place to nurture a CEO. But the question is, are we very far from the truth or very close to the truth? We'll find out after my presentation today. At this juncture, I'd like to say that more than 70% of newly established businesses in Nigeria, a lot of times close up after 1 to 3 years. You could do your findings. A lot of people set up businesses, and after the first year, second year, third year, they are not able to stay. They're not able to cope, or they're not able, excuse me. Thank you very much. So a lot of people set up businesses in Nigeria, and after 1 to 3 years, they're not able to thrive. Speaking about international investors, we're talking about investors across Africa, you're talking about we investors in Nigeria, or we business owners in Nigeria. Now, multiple foreign investors and business owners, like I said, choose to cut their losses and move elsewhere to do business. The MC had earlier on highlighted Ghana, how peaceful Ghana is, how to a reasonable extent very secure Ghana is, and how effortless it is to do business in Ghana. But the point is, it's not all the way bleak for Nigeria. I'll still come to the success stories. Thank you, DJ. It goes without saying that Nigeria has the potential to be one of the top industrialized and commercially viable nations in Africa. But a series of successive bad policies, gross mismanagement of resources have contributed immensely to impeding the growth and commercialization of our country. While it is very easy and convenient to completely blame the government for a lot of things that are not working in Nigeria, I think we the masses as well need to sit down and check ourselves, because we also share in the blame. Maybe 1%, maybe 5%, but of course, I totally agree. The government takes the most of this blame, because I would always say, government has no business doing business, but it is government's responsibility to provide an enabling environment for me to do business and survive. And so if the environment is not there, of course I hold the government responsible. Now, I've said some of these problems lie within the masses if we are to be objective with ourselves, like I did say, but they share in a very small fraction of the blame. Every CEO and business, whether established or a startup in Nigeria, bears within it the seeds of success or failure. In simple terms, a CEO is someone who implements the mission and vision of a company, whether small or big, and serves as a linkage between the directors, the staff, and whoever works in that company. That's breaking it down in layman terms. Let's now begin with the challenges. The subject matter for today is the challenges and triumphs of Nigerian CEOs in the 21st century. It is one thing to be great at what you do, I always tell people. It's one thing to be great at what you do and you're globally competitive. It's one thing to be good at what you do in Nigeria and the world recognizes what you do and says, oh, you're an expert. And so if you're excelling in Nigeria as a business owner, and you can excel out of Nigeria, indeed you're an expert. So there are... Thank you very much. And so there are basic standards that are yardsticks for judgment. Now, I'd like to begin with the challenges. One of the main challenges that Nigeria is saddled with, as we are very aware, is insecurity. A very top-ranking police officer in the country is seated right here, and I'm sure you would agree with me. No investor in this world would want to come into an environment that is not safe. In as much as we try to, you know, I wouldn't say we're prejudiced, but in as much as we assume that we're from one God, we're from one creation, we're one being, the blacks are totally different from the whites. We are blacks, and so we know how to manage ourselves. We could discriminate against ourselves, but we're just ethnicity racist to each other. We're ethnicity discriminative to each other. We don't discriminate ourselves against skin color. But an investor from a country out of Africa wants to come to a country in Africa where he knows that he's secure. Now, insecurity being a major challenge in Nigeria affects the economy. But before I go into that, I'd like to say that domestic terrorism, kidnapping, communal clashes are just few of the threats to national security Nigeria faces on a daily basis. The spree of kidnapping is something that is not totally strange to us. We are very familiar. We are very, very familiar with that particular drawback. Theft and organized armed robbery are the business owner's worst nightmare. And the implications of this is that business owners and organizations spend more than is appropriate on security measures, and this increases the cost of running a business in our country. As much as it's very helpful to say, Nigeria is a country where you have to be your brother's keeper. I mean, the police would always tell you, police is your friend. If you find any misconduct around your environment, you find things that you don't feel so comfortable with, report to the police. It's, you know, it's a common saying. But the question is this what is obtainable in other countries around Africa? How have they been able to excel in terms of security? Are there measures we can put in place to make our security system better? Yes, indeed, the Nigerian police force is doing its best. It's doing a lot. The security agencies and platforms are doing their best, but I think there's still so much to be done. The government still needs to provide funding. The government still needs to provide an enabling environment for these security personnel to be able to thrive, to protect us, and of course, make our environment and society more convenient for investors. Away from insecurity, I'd like to talk about power supply. So part of what I do, or part of my mandate, is speaking on oil and gas inclined platforms, power and energy. And so I can talk about power and energy, oil and gas investments, like at the top of my head. So power and energy is like a major menace in Nigeria. It's something that affects me too, because we spend a lot of money on generators. And then when I talk about, you spend a lot of money powering your generators, fuel and diesel, people talk about solar energy. Yes, indeed, solar energy. But has Nigeria gotten to the point where people are able to explore solar? An average man on the streets, and a small SME, a barber, hairdresser, they don't know what is solar. We haven't advanced to that point where you can conveniently walk up to them and tell them, you can actually use solar. Solar is cheaper. What everybody's familiar with is electricity. Yes, indeed, I appreciate the fact that Nigeria is trying so hard to catch up with China and so many other countries that are highly industrialized, but it's a gradual process. Like, you need to take the first step, and from the first step, you go to the next step. From the next step, you proceed to the next step. At least we should try as much as we can to fix electricity. We should try as much as we can to fix power from the grid. Power from the grid is NEPA, light to use in your house. When we're done with that, when we, we've made appreciable progress with that. We can now begin to explore renewable energy like solar, wind, and so on and so forth, like South Africa is doing. And so for power supply, I'd like to say that it's Nigeria's biggest problem, whether anybody likes it or not. If you fix power, I've always said that you fix like 80% of the problems of Nigeria, because if you fix power, young people will be able to have electricity to do whatever it is they want to do. They'll be able to think more creatively. Personally, I can't stay in the dark. And so I keep telling people Nigeria is tired of, you know, being Africa, dark continent. We're tired of being referred to as a continent in the dark. And Nigeria is tired of being operating on fluctuating power supply. And so I'd like to round off power supply, the point there, by saying that access to power expands the number and varieties of businesses. And this means that small businesses, SMEs, will function more effectively if we had adequate power supply. Speaking about power supply, I'd like to move on to lack of adequate infrastructure. Still speaking about the challenges that CEOs in Nigeria face in running their businesses in this 21st century. Lack of infrastructure, I mean, internet connectivity. We spend so much on data. We spend so much on internet, on Wi-Fi. I'm sure like 99.9% of the people here would always get on their phones after every 5 minutes to check what is happening on social media and all that. I don't blame them. Everybody needs to keep abreast of what's happening in the world. You need to keep abreast with global trends. And so internet connectivity in some countries is like the cheapest thing. And then you have housing very expensive. You might have food very expensive. But internet is something that should never be lacking in any society. If a society has to advance, if the CEOs of any country has to have to flourish, you need to make internet connectivity available to them. We lack roads. I mean, I once traveled to, one of the countries in Europe, and I was having a discussion with someone, and the person said, importing things from this country, it was actually Hungary, to Nigeria, it's way cheaper than importing things from Rwanda to Nigeria, which is totally true. For people who follow the trends in investment, for people who follow how the markets move, it is very expensive to import even across West Africa than it is to import from Europe, or even from the Middle East, or even from a country in Asia. And that's because we don't have infrastructure. The roads are terrible, the roads are bad. In the conference I was recently a part of, a speaker was actually talking about some of the issues she faced in transporting goods from Nigeria to Ghana, and from ECOWAS, immigration, I mean, I don't want to start highlighting all of that. It is a nightmare indeed, because I think as a continent, we're supposed to operate as a single entity. I mean, you go to the Schengen areas, one Schengen passport gives you an opportunity to travel to all the Schengen areas in Germany. Why are we not having that in Africa? Why do I need to travel to Liberia and I need to go through all the bottlenecks of immigration? I'm traveling to South Africa, I stand the risk of getting denied a visa. And so all of this infrastructure, speaking about immigration and all of that, needs to be checked if African CEOs should excel in their businesses. Still speaking about lack of adequate infrastructure, power supply is indeed a major challenge. Sometimes in my house I run out of water when there's no light to pump water. You have to use your generator, your own boss, so to speak. You have to use your generator to pump water or whatever power means or whatever. You have to provide your own water if there's no light to pump water. Why should Nigeria be at that stage at this point? We shouldn't. But the point is, the reality is that we are there, and so we need to find ways and seek possible solutions on how to come out of it. You can't just sit down and be lamenting, oh, the country is not working, this is not happening. You make the things happen for yourself. You know, start small from 1% and you are graduating to 5%, 6%, 7%. You don't have to wait for the government to do everything, because if you wait for the government to do everything, my dear, you're stuck. Government will never do everything for you in Nigeria, at least not for now. So water supply is indeed a very huge challenge. Rails, ports, to name a few. It's indeed a challenge in Nigeria for CEOs. So anybody who's thinking about doing business in Nigeria, you need to consider the rails, the ports, the roads, power, very important, water, to name a few. So for number three, I beg your pardon, I'd like to say the entire West Africa combined is 8 times the population of Japan. I'm sorry, I can't talk about Nigeria without touching on Africa. The entire West Africa, speaking about the countries in West Africa, Ghana, Liberia, Sao Tome Principe, Nigeria, Guinea-Bissau, to name a few, the entire countries in West Africa combined, is only 8 times the population of Ghana. It's actually 8 times the population of Japan. I beg your pardon. Despite this reality, 8 times the population of Japan, our power and electricity capacity is only half of what Japan has. West Africa's electricity access is at 47%, the entire West Africa combined, whereas China's access rate is at 10%. India is at 82% in 2016, and Brazil has an access rate of 97. China is at 100, India is at 82, Brazil is at 97. West Africa is at what? West Africa is at 47. So we speak about corruption. Corruption is like, whoa, okay, so this present administration is very particular about corruption. His Excellency President Muhammadu Buhari, one of his, 4-point agenda when he was coming into government was upscaling SMEs, corruption, security, and then Nigeria's economy. Corruption is something that he's been very particular about. Whether or not he's doing a very good job, I am not here to be a judge. I leave that to each and every one of us to be judges, and I leave that to the international community to weigh in. But the point is, corruption remains a bane in our society. Corruption remains a devil in our society. It is a menace that previous administrations have tried as much as they can to battle, but a lot of people would say even they are corrupt, and the present administration is also trying so hard to battle. But the point is, corruption affects each and every one of us. We might not necessarily understand what that means, but when you go out of Nigeria to so many other countries and you see how things are done on merit, you begin to understand that in Nigeria, it is not safe for your children and your children unborn. Nobody wants to walk round and round in circles. I mean, you're living in a country where you struggle as a parent, you give birth to children, your children are struggling, and then they give birth to another set of children that are struggling because they don't have the opportunities of going abroad to get foreign to get international education and all of those international backgrounds, or they don't have the expertise, like some people who have children here and send them abroad. Now, the point is, you might say, oh, it doesn't necessarily affect me. It doesn't affect me directly, but it does. Because like I said, nobody wants to be running round and round in circles without making appreciable progress. In terms of corruption, I'd like to say very quickly that Nigeria should try as much as it can, if it must create an enabling environment for its CEOs to survive, to give out contracts on merit. Give out contracts to people because they are good at the job. Give out jobs to people because they deserve the jobs. They graduated with good grades from their schools. They've proven capacity. Not because they are your family members, not because they are your friends. I am somebody who would never fall into that category. I would never give you something because I feel like you are entitled to it. Nobody's entitled to anything. If you want to get something from me, or you want to get something from the platform I work with, you have to prove capacity. Tell me that you are determined. Tell me that you are able. Tell me that you are capable of doing the job and you get the job. I think if everybody had the same kind of mentality, it would be a very, very big way to transform our country. It would be a very, very big way to transform capacity. So away from corruption, I'd like to say that reports released by Transparency International shows that Nigeria ranks number 144 out of 180 countries. That is not impressive at all. Transparency International 2019 report, Nigeria is number 144 out of number 180. Why couldn't we be at number 1? You know, why couldn't we be at number 50? Why couldn't we be at number 100? Well, number 144 rather, very close to 180. So I'd like to say government awarding contracts, like I said, to companies based on merit. Rather, they award contracts to companies based on what they stand to gain. We pay security agencies, everybody needs to bribe, everybody. But at the end of the day, you don't really blame the people because it's the society they find themselves. But like I did say, the change we expect, the change we anticipate, the change we want, starts with very little efforts. If we continue making this appreciable little effort, before you know what's happening in the next decades and centuries, we might not be able to reap from these benefits, but our children and our children's children will be able to reap from the benefits. Now, government policies, I'd quickly like to run through this. A lot of policies favor the already established business companies. And we already know that a lot of policies in Nigeria don't necessarily favor SMEs, small, medium enterprises, medium-scale enterprises. They favor people who are already established. Everybody wants to know your status. I mean, it happens to me all the time. You're walking somewhere, and people see that, oh, you're small. Okay, so nobody wants to talk to you. Nobody really respects you. And then when they now find out, oh, you're this person or you're that person, everybody's like, oh, yes, yes, yes. It's not supposed to be so. We need to reorientate ourselves. We need to respect people for who they are, what they've been able to achieve, whether or not you know them, rather than their status. And so government needs to put policies to support small-scale enterprises, medium-scale enterprises, businesses that truly deserve to survive, not because of some people who have been able to make a name for themselves and they are up there on the top echelon. So I'd like to say government regulates the market with policies, and some of these policies determine how much tax you pay, the exchange rates. We all know the stories of exchange rates, immigration laws, to name a few. Very quickly, I'd like to talk about access to funds. Lack of capital is a major challenge to entrepreneurs and foreign investors in Nigeria, and despite lack of capital is a major challenge to foreign investors and entrepreneurs in Nigeria. And despite efforts by the government to provide aids in forms of loans and grants, a lot of business owners still have limited access to these funds. A lot of people go to Bank of Industry, you go to different banks, you go to all of these financial institutions. Are you able to access loans? Are you able to access grants? A lot of them won't give you loans, won't give you grants, because you don't have a track record. You're not linked to the big companies. They feel like, oh, you cannot necessarily do anything with these monies they'll give you. And so you have to get like a guarantor from some of these. It is not supposed to be so, because majority of these Nigerians, 90% of Nigerians, would never really have access to some of this highly profiled people. And so if we want businesses, small-scale CEOs, medium-scale CEOs to thrive in Nigeria, we need to review government policies. So we've been talking about all of these challenges. Like I said, it's not all the way bleak. When you talk about the negatives, I like to start with the positives, but the subject said challenges and triumphs. So that's why I start with the negatives. So when the challenges and the negatives are positives, there's never a minus, minus, minus in everything. There's a minus plus. There's always a plus. So there's black and white. So let's balance it up. Now, I'd like to begin with the positives by talking about the proposed success stories in Nigeria before I talk about the actual success stories in Nigeria. Proposed success stories in Nigeria: oil and gas, my forte. Dangote,